Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, I'd like to welcome you to another episode of Grim Squadron Radio, coming at you live from the Outer Rim territories. Joining me, as always, is my co-host, Jedi Luigi. I'm Zeph, and joining us today is a very special guest, a man who took second at our own store championships, first at the Plainsview store championships. And 17th at the Hoth Open. Pretty impressive results. I'd like to welcome you all, Matthew Kish. Matt, how you
Hey
doing?
guys.
How you doing, Matt?
Good.
It's good. It's good.
Good.
So, tell us a little about yourself. How you got an X-Wing?
I guess I started when it first came out for a little bit and then picked it back up in maybe wave 7.
Okay.
All right.
It was right when the robots first came out and that whole scum stuff came out. I looked at it, I was like, what is that? And then one of my friends, Eric, got me into it.
Okay.
That's cool,
Yeah.
man.
That'd be wave six.
Robots have always been huge for you, man. That's like your thing.
Yeah, I started to play them and played competitively with them. And it's been pretty good.
That's cool, man. That's cool. One of the big things about being a good player, not just an X-Wing, but in general, is consistency. And out here on the island, I would say you're one of the most consistent players out there in terms of placing. It's either you're always in the top three, usually top two, always on the top table. I mean, it's just really impressive results. And 17th at the Hoth Open, how many people were there?
251.
Oh, that Jesus. That's a pretty impressive standing, I would think.
Thank you.
So what do we got on the docket today, Luigi?
Today on the docket, we have the official ID ruling by Fantasy Flight Games. Gotta talk about that first.
Yeah, that was very interesting because that they posted their official ruling about that right after we had our first podcast.
Yes, they did. I wish they had just posted a little earlier. Ooh.
Yeah, right, so we'd have
But.
more to talk about in the first episode. So what was their final judgment?
Well, they realized that it doesn't really quite work in the Swiss standard, the semi-Swiss standard kind of thing that X-Wing has, where it's only one match and the single elimination, so as it is. Whereas in like Magic, you have like three different matches each game,
I think like
which one?
each game of Magic is like a best of three, I think.
Yes, it is. And in X-Wing, it's not. It's one and done.
Best of
So
ones in the Swiss group stage. It's not even true Swiss either. It's
now
a randomized Swiss within. It's based off your win loss. So if like all the people who in like the first round, second round got 1-0, they're paired against all the other 1-0s. The 0-1s get paired randomly against the 0-1s. It doesn't matter about your MOV. However, unless there's like if there's 14 people, let's say, and the 1-0 and the 0-1 split. This actually happened to me yesterday in the tournament that we had out here at Brothers Grimm. I went 1-0 in my first match. Won my first match. My second match was against the highest MOV 0-1 person. Because the split was 7-7, there were 14 participants. So that's the only part. That's the only time when MOV matters when it comes to Fantasy Flight's kind of a randomized Swiss.
Yep. That indeed.
So their ruling was what? What are their take on IDs after the whole blowout at Roanoke and people drawing dongs about IDs on their
Well,
streams?
effectively, they're dropping draws, period, in X-Wing, as far as the article like suggests.
Draws and overall, like there's no draws, not
Yeah.
even.
I know definitely like intentional draws are going away, but
Okay.
like we're not planning. It's like draws, yeah.
So like
So.
if we go to time and I killed 75 points and you killed 75 points, how is that resolved?
They might just it could be up to initiative. They're they're working on changes right now as we speak.
Right, because they didn't. This isn't effective immediately, right?
No, it's after the regionals are over because the first two regionals had intentional drawings, and to be consistent, they're just gonna stick with it until it's over.
I mean, it wasn't just the first couple regionals that had. I think Hoth Open had it too, didn't it, Matt?
Yes,
Do
he
you
did.
know?
Yeah.
Yes, the Hoth Open had it.
How did that play into your standings?
For me, it didn't come into play.
Okay.
Okay. Did you hear anybody else like you hear an intentional draw and like it caused someone not to be able to make the top 16 cut or something? Or no, nothing like that happened.
I didn't hear too much. I think maybe the guys that were kind of locked in already may have,
Okay.
but I can't confirm that. I wasn't really around them at the time.
Okay.
Okay. Well,
No, that's fair.
we'll get more into
They.
your run at Hoth in a bit, 'cause that's gonna be part of our tournament segment. But there's big news. Want to talk a big about this big news from Fantasy Flight? The ID ruling is huge. We're taking out IDs effective August 1st.
Yep.
There was another change to their
Yeah.
competitive structure. Tell me about that.
The Premier Tournament structure is becoming a graduated cut. It's going to be like what we saw at the Hoth Open.
Okay.
So national championships, it's going to be what up to 6 rounds of Swiss, graduated cut to a predetermined number of players by standings,
Okay.
and an additional maximum bonus number of players by ranking with the same number of tournament points as the last player captured in the predetermined number. And then two or three additional rounds of Swiss pairings
Okay.
on the following day, and then standings based to cut elimination rounds and play until a champion is crowned.
So, in layman's terms, what's the TLDR in all of this? Like, give me an example.
So as I'm reading this right now, so like instead of what we had at the regional where it's you play a number of rounds and then it's just the top 16 cut,
Okay.
you get a graduated cut and
What do you mean by
the
graduated?
Sorry, I've been reading this like all day and I'm trying to figure everything out.
Okay.
Matt, can you tell us a little bit about how the cut was at Hoth? Because that's the same kind of cut they used.
Yeah, sure. So, basically the first cut, I guess if you want to call it, was over 2 separate days. So I think there was officially 251 players.
Okay.
So about, let's say 127, 125. So first day was Thursday. The second day was Friday. Both one, day one cut, so I played on Friday, and then the cut was on Saturday. And the way they did it was is you played 6 games and you had to score at least 18 points to make it to day two. So
Okay.
you needed 3 wins and a modified win, so like 4 wins basically. One of them could be modified.
Okay.
And those points carried into the second round or the second day, but MOV did not transfer over. So it
Okay.
was really just
Oh.
you won, you got your game points, whether it's 5 or 3 or 1 or whatever, and you needed to win at least 4 games out of 6.
So it's just whoever gets four and two, or five and one, 6-0. That's what you need to do. Okay, so I guess it scales with the number of participants. The more people that play, the more people are in the initial cut.
Okay, I kind of like
And then
that.
it brackets down from there, I think.
Yeah, it looks like a top 128, top 16, top 8, and then top 4.
That goes from 128 to 16. That's a pretty
Well,
huge
that's the
divide.
award prizes anyway.
Okay.
So I'm assuming there's like more cuts between that.
Now the
Okay.
award, those top 32 got awards.
Oh, okay, cool.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So you got something swanky.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Right. I like that the graduated cut.
Yeah, I mean it's definitely a new take, and it's been proven with the Hoth Open, and I think they're gonna stick to it. And it allows more people to, I guess, make it in, because it doesn't make sense. Like, oh, we have like a regional turnout of 200 people, only like the top 8 go, and then the rest are like out. It
Sit
allows you
with,
to like climb back after like a pretty mediocre day of Swiss.
All right, that's something I can look forward to.
That's good. That's good. That's good. But that doesn't take effect this round of regionals either.
No, it does not. Well, that's for like the
Okay.
premier national events, I
Okay.
think.
This does not affect regionals or.
Not until not I don't see any news about that. I think regionals are as is until
Okay.
the latest the new FAQs and stuff come out. They
All
could
right.
change it. We'll have to wait and see.
That's good. All right. So what else do we got? What do we got? We have some maybe tournament results.
Oh, yes, we do. We have two regionals that just finished today. In fact, we have in Niles, Illinois, the Pastimes regional.
Okay.
That was 2 days.
Where is pet? Where is that?
Illinois.
Illinois.
Yeah, I just
I
said
thought it was
that.
in Chicago.
No, there's no. That was
Niles, Illinois. Where is that? That sounds
wait,
like
was it Chicago? Did I get these
an
mixed
outer
up?
rim.
Let me double check that. Sorry, guys.
I have never even heard of a
I may
place
have.
called Niles. It might be Niles, Illinois.
I think I got it that
We're
mixed up. That's my
failing
bad.
geography right now, actually.
See, my bad.
Yeah, it's a real place.
It's going
We do
by.
right now.
Yeah, I'm double checking. Sorry, everybody.
That's all right.
I feel like.
So, while we look where exactly Niles is, it looks actually like it's just south of
OH, come on.
Chicago, I think. No, it's just north of Chicago, actually. So, it's a Chicago suburb. It's a Chicago.
Oh, yes, it's a Chicago suburb, that's why. All
It's
right.
the Chicago regional.
Yes.
And who won?
Who won? Crack Swarm did.
Crack Swarm. Oh, that's
Yep.
cool.
It was Howlrunner, Scourge, Mauler Mythal, and Black Crack Ties.
Do they all have crack?
Yeah, they do it, everyone.
So it's kind of like a crack aces.
Yeah, well, three crack aces and then three crack scrubs.
Yeah.
It was something to look at. I actually watched that match. They were streaming it. Gold Squadron podcast.
Oh, cool.
Thank you guys for streaming that. That was fun
Shout
to
out to
watch.
Gold Squadron for streaming the regionals, man.
So I have some fun facts that I learned in the stream.
What'd you learn?
There were no scum in the top eight of that regional.
That's brutal.
Yeah. There were only 2 to 3 U-boat lists in the top 16.
Were they dedicated trip U-boats?
As far as I'm aware, yes, or at least mixed. There were
So
de
it wasn't like a Dengar loaded to
no,
the
no, no,
gills
no. I don't
with
think
like
so.
upgrades and a title and all that.
Pretty sure they were actually just U-boats.
Okay.
The standard U-boat list. There were a lot of crack swarms, apparently.
Okay.
The second place winner, the second place rebel player, actually, with Poe, Jake, and Kyle Katarn, had versed quite a few swarms that day.
That's a very interesting setup. Matt, what do you think about that?
Oh, Matt, go ahead.
The rebel list? Yeah.
Yeah, Poe, Jake, and Kyle. Do we have like specifics on that? Let me bring
I
that
do have
up.
specifics. Poe had VI, R5P9, and auto thrusters. Jake had PI, push the limit. I believe he had either VI or adaptability or something like that.
Okay.
And he also had P rockets.
Rockets, all right.
Rockets
Shotgun.
and auto thrusters, if I am doing that correctly.
Definitely should have auto thrusters if you're an
Along with the
A-wing.
title, of course. And then Kyle Katarn had auto blaster turret, Chewie, and crack, not crack shot, adaptability, I think.
Didn't he also have Moldy Crow or no?
Yeah, he did have multi-crow.
Okay.
So what the list did is Kyle Katarn would feed focus tokens to either Jake, so Jake could do 4 actions a turn, or give a focus to Poe, who would target lock an opponent, and have that focus to regen at the end of the round.
That's
Wow.
ridiculous.
Yeah. It got him up to second place, so I'm gonna say that works pretty well. And Chewie crew is something else. Like, he dodged double damages and the damage engine crit. It absorbs, let's see, 2 damage. And you just regen. It's pretty good, actually.
Gotta add you get to I believe the way it works is that you delete
You delete the
crit of
crit.
your choice, and then you take regen a shield.
Yes, you do. So basically, if he would ever take a hit and a crit, and then lose a shield, take the crit, he would go, "No, no, I'm just gonna go back to full health."
That's a pretty ridiculously tanky Hawk on the cheap.
It is.
Isn't Chewie like what, 4 points? I think
he's 4 points.
How do you feel about that, Matt?
Chewie's solid. It's like, you know, shield. It's almost like a shield and a hull upgrade combined.
Mm-hmm.
And like a determination too. It's like 3 for 1.
Yeah, or the droid on the on like people running on Tel.
Yeah.
Yeah, salvage astromech. It's basically Chewie's a really good crew card, and I did not see this list coming out of anywhere. So that's, the fact that
that's like an out of left field thing.
Yeah, I mean,
go ahead.
My thought on that is he's got to fly that really well. I mean,
he did.
Yeah.
He really did.
Air skill, I think.
Mhm.
But pretty interesting list for sure.
That's something I definitely want to try. It sounds like a lot of fun too.
Yeah, a lot of synergy.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
As a fellow scum player, Matt, there's no scum in top 8 and U-boats. It's like 2-3 in the top 16. Is this a doom meta for us?
No.
Not at all.
No, we're good.
So maybe it's just like a regional thing. Like over there, Chicago, like the scum pilots are absolutely like terrible or at least mediocre. Not to flame anyone in particular, but like Brobots won Germany, and didn't U-boats win Hoth?
Yes, they did. Good. But yeah, so U-boats did win Hoth.
Yes, they did.
Mm-hmm. So, I think it's just the meta is very diverse right now.
Oh, absolutely. It's very random. I mean, there's a lot of good lists out there, in my opinion.
A lot of interesting stuff, and there's a lot of like unique things we can do with the Jumpmaster or with like maybe a YV666 setup. I was actually looking at a setup today. You were telling me yesterday about it. I call it the Geonosian Buzzsaw with the Trandoshan Slaver with Zuckus. Didn't you? I think you saw this at Hoth, right? With Zuckus, yeah. The Gunner, and what was the other thing that I'm missing? Zuckus, Gunner, Bosk.
Bosk, yeah.
So tell me how that works, man, because you saw it live in action.
Yeah, so basically, you know, the thing tries to get into range 1, and he'll shoot at you, and then initially he wants to miss. So he'll make you he'll make you re-roll blanks and take stress.
Okay.
Right? So you evade it, and then when he evades it, Gunner triggers with Bosk, so then he shoots you the second time with a focus target lock from Bosk, and then he uses Zuckus again to make you not evade. So it's really nasty. I mean, he piles up the stress, but it doesn't really care about that because it's not like it's gonna turn around anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very interesting. It was kind of scary, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, because you get to selectively. So like on the initial roll, if your initial roll is like amazing, you can force them to just dodge it. To not dodge it, or like if your initial roll is crap, you can like, oh, I rolled like 4 blanks and oh, the hit goes through. No, you're gonna re-roll your blanks.
Exactly. Yeah, you don't. It's either like I miss or like do massive damage.
That seems pretty ridiculous. It's kind of like imagine if this was like on Han or something. It's kind of like a reverse Han. Like instead of like, all right, my roll is crap, I'll just re-roll it. It's like no. I want you to take a specific amount of damage, and I will ensure that it goes through.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I was playing around with a list earlier, so it included that setup, the Chel Trevera that I ran yesterday against you, with the U-boat build.
Nice.
And a PS4 Dorsal Hog. So there's a lot of meat, there's a lot of just raw damage. There's the setup from Tel with the plasma torps into the buzzsaw where I'm like, I can just make you take 3 to 4 damage, and there might be crits in there. And then the dorsal hog for a little bit of, you know, it's a neat little 24 point filler. I don't know of a better way to fill 24 points. I'd rather take a tricked out Y-wing with dorsal turret unhinged and the title than like two little Z95s. I think that's better point spent.
That's a fair assessment. Let's before we get like off track, let's talk about the Missouri regional.
Didn't that also happen yesterday and today?
Yes, it did. Independence, Missouri, the Game Cafe. Our winner was Palp Aces. I'm going to tell you right now what that Palp Ace list was.
Okay.
It was Echo with VI, Advanced Cloaking Device, Fire Control System, and Callus. Yeah, Callus. Then you had the Inquisitor with Push the Limit, Auto Thrusters, and the title. And then Omicron Group Pilot with Palpatine at 99 points.
Star Wars Rebels making a really big impact in X-Wing these days.
Yeah, it is. Second place, the winner. I really like it. It was a scum list.
Okay.
Yeah, you're still in the meta. Don't worry. Zuckus with VI, a fire control system, and the title that gives the tractor beam. Tel Trevera with Deadeye, R4, Proton Torpedoes, Extra Munitions, Guidance Chips, and Boba Fett. And then you had Palob with a Twin Laser Turret, 4 LOM, and then Crackshot at, I believe that was 100 points.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Didn't he Boba the wrong thing?
Yes, he did.
What did Boba?
Matt, what, out of all those things on the Imperial list, like if you dealt a crit, he dealt a crit to Echo, what would you strip from Echo?
I'd probably go for the Advanced Cloaking Device.
Yeah, me too.
What do you both would do that?
Yeah, that's. I mean, Callus is already in effect, so stripping him would be kind of pointless because his effect's already there. The fire control might be all right, but the big thing's the recloak because you don't want to like even more so if it was Whisper, because that's what ensures that you don't get just reprisal shots because your native agility is only 2. That's what brings you to 4 and 4 is the recloak. Yep. So you fire, you recloak, and then you get to dance next turn again.
Okay. Well, according to forum user LJ Coolio, the scum player stripped Veteran Instincts. Veteran Instincts.
Why?
I can't say because
makes him what, a 6?
Yeah, makes him 6. Scum is. The Zuckus is already a pilot skill 9, Tel Trevera is 7, and Palob is 5.
So, I guess it's kind of like robbing you of the
chance to shoot before Tel.
Yeah, it's kind of robbing you of the recloak, except not.
No. I would rather there just be no recloak for Palob just to go, hey look, here's the damage. No, you're gone.
Yeah, because you're forcing him to take the action. You're forcing him to do 2 turns what he would do in 1.
Yeah. And then when he's decloaked, he can't recloak after he decloaks. So Palop would just go, hey, I have 3 dice twice versus your 2 dice. I'm probably going to get that last damage on you and kill you.
That was definitely a misplay.
I can't see that. We did have twin laser turrets in the top 4.
Really?
Of that. Yep, it was Miranda, 2 Gold Squadron pilots, and I think 1 or 2 Zs?
Probably one
Z, yeah. But yeah. Alright, yeah, no, I have it now. It was Miranda with TLT, C-3PO, Advanced Slam, 2 Gold Squadron TLTs, and then a Bandit. They beat triple jumps to get there.
Wow.
I mean, that's really consistent damage.
It is. Absolutely. The Bandit's the blocker. The Gold Squadron can either TLT or just jump into range 1 and bump them. Mm. And then Miranda can, if she's about to get shot by torpedoes, go, no, I'm just going to slam away.
Yeah.
You just slam. And that's it. You're good.
I mean, what's the native dice on the dodge dice on the K-Wing? I think it's 1, right?
It's only 1.
Only
so
1. So you roll with it kind of like the 1300. Like, oh, I'm going to guess none. And off you go.
And Miranda has regen, too. Don't forget about that. Or
and the regen. That's a really tanky hawk. And what's interesting is that I could see this beating U-boats. Because you have to be in a specific arc for the torps, you just kind of like arc dodge in the clowniest of fashions because your dial is terrible because you're rebels and you're running Y-wing, so you don't have the unhinged.
Mm-hmm.
And you just keep shooting at these things. They only have two dodge, mm-hmm. and although they could fire 360, their primary thing is I'm gonna hit you with the four dice torp.
Yeah.
And they just they don't have like auto thrusters or anything, and they're big bases, so it's really easy to just land the damage. And compared to other big bases, they don't have a lot of meat on them.
Oh yeah, no, they're only 9 hull. They actually as much as the K-wing that they were versing.
Yeah.
And the K-wing could regen. Or get more damage, so like it could get 4 dice at range 1 if it really wanted to, and just go, you're dead.
Mm. I can definitely see that beating out U-boats, but so how did that list lose? What did they lose to, do you know?
They either lost to, because they made the top 4.
Okay.
They either lost to the scum list.
Okay.
Or the palp aces, or the third list, which I cannot find at the moment.
Okay.
Because they just happened today, I can't find a lot of information about them.
Yeah. And I don't think this one wasn't being streamed, I think.
No, it was not. I couldn't find it anywhere. We know because they beat U-boats that they were in the top 8 at least.
Okay.
So you had scum in the top 8 and the top 2 of the Missouri Regional and Game Cafe. So that's good. I think we're seeing a pretty diverse meta. I mean, Rebel Regen.
That's back. Regen is back. Bring out your Poes. Bring out your, I don't know, Luke Skywalkers, your Wes Jansons.
Mm-hmm.
Throw on that R2-D2. Break out your Biggs. Have him tank it up.
Yeah.
Do it up, man. Rebels are back. And Rebels are pretty huge right now.
Yeah, I think everyone figured out how to beat U-boats. And now the meta's just going back to the, you get the staples. You got Rebel Regen, you got Crackstorm, you got Palp Aces. The U-boats have found their niche. People are going to be playing them for a while and finding more ways to modify them.
See, I definitely think on the onset of this meta, and Matt, maybe you can agree that like everyone thought like U-boats were going to be like super huge. This is what's going to be winning tournaments. And it won Hoth Open, but that Hoth Open came, like, I think, right after Wave 8 dropped. So yeah, that was like the first big tournament, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was like 2 or 3 weeks out, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe even a week.
Yeah. So this is like the meta's fresh, and people, they kind of get psyched out. Oh, 3 U-boats. What do I do? And then they just eat all these torps because they think they can joust it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think jousting the U-boats is the way to go. You kind of have to... Kind of like if you were running against... It reminds me of a match I played against our buddy Dave. He was running a block of 6 Z95s. It was a Blount, and it was a Tala Swarm. I think 4 of the Talas had the concussion missiles.
Yep.
Blount had the Thread Tracers, and I think one was there for effect. And that setup is kind of like... Think back to like a Roman Legion column. And Blount is like a Centurion, and he goes, that guy, and all the Z95 Legionnaires just throw their pilum, and now they fire their concussion missiles, and then they draw their 2-dice Gladius. And your main objective, right, is to rob them of throwing their pilum. And my match against him, I was able to stay back just out of missile range. I think he was just able to... He threw the lock onto one of my Y-Wings that I was playing. But he didn't fire all those missiles that turn. I don't remember why. I'm not necessarily sure. I don't remember. Next turn, I should have just went like 4 forward, but I actually K-turned, thinking he'd overshoot me. But I just caused a giant car accident. He only got one of those missiles off, so 3 Z95s died with their ordnance, and they didn't get it off. It was pretty huge. And I think U-boats nowadays, you have to do the same thing where you have to dodge their giant torpedo of doom arc get in their face and just make sure that they never fire their ordnance and they die wasting it. And that's the big, that's the downside with ordnance. I mean, that's why no one played it before. People are playing it now because guidance ships. Guidance ships are huge. I love those things. They're, it's what makes ordnance viable. Especially, and the Jumpmaster is such a great platform for ordnance because of how maneuverable it is and how you can set it up with Deadeye into the R2 or the R4 agromech with the follow-up reroll, and then you have yourself the guidance chips. So, and this actually happened against you, Matt, when we were playing on the top table yesterday at the Grim tournament. I rolled two hits, a blank, and an eyeball, and with Proton Torps, that's three hits and a crit.
Yep.
And I didn't even have to reroll. I don't have to do anything. I just sit there, and I'm like, oh, here you go. Let's take the damage.
It's huge. Look. Go ahead, Matt.
I just said ouch.
Yeah. I'm bringing back bad memories of that.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely huge. But like you said, the major weakness is... if you can kill a U-boat before it fires, it's amazing. I had an awesome match against Little Pat yesterday at that tournament. I was there too.
Yeah, he was running the three U-boats.
Second match, because the first match I blew it. I blew it against Matt.
Oh really?
Yeah, no. I just,
oh, you guys played.
We did play. I
How'd
lost.
How'd that go? Oh.
I just boof. I lost that.
Well, what were you playing?
I was playing a list I came up with as soon as I heard about the Itani Mind Link upgrade.
Oh, really?
Like, as soon as I found out about that, I was like, wait, I can do something with this. And after, like, 5 minutes of theory crafting, I made it. It was, I call it Mind Fives.
All right. How does this work?
It's, okay, so everyone in this list, I'll name the list now. It's, everyone in this list is Pilot Skill 5. They all have EPTs. They all take Itani Mind Link. And each one of them has a way to get a focus token.
So other than doing the action, right?
Other than doing the action, yes. So you start off with Guri. EPT, a tiny mind link, and then you give her auto thrusters. 33 points, not too bad.
Mm-hmm.
3-3-4-1 with amazing actions it can do, except for the evade. I wish it could evade. But regardless. And the dial isn't... It's pretty good dial. I wish it was had a few more greens, but there you go.
What else do you have in that list?
Well, let me tell you what Guri does. At range one, if there's an enemy at range one of her during the start of the combat phase, she gets a focus token. So if she does like an S loop behind someone, gets a stress, she can still get the token as long as they're at range one.
Or just boost in her face.
Or boost in their face, yeah. Or if you target lock and you target lock and they're already at range one, you just go, all right, I'm gonna get a free focus. Cool. Mm-hmm. Then you have the next guy is just a Tansari Point veteran. Sick with the title, the mind link, and the mangler cannon.
Mm.
It doesn't have a way to get a focus token.
This is the only guy that actually does not have the ability to get it. Yeah.
Yes. But they do have the evade action.
Okay.
They do have the barrel roll for repositioning. And the mangler cannon is a nice, heavy hitting punch. So, like, someone like Guri fires first, rips the shields, and the mangler cannon goes. Here's two hits and a crit, or like yesterday I got like three crits three times, and it was lovely.
Yo, manglers are huge on the psychs. They're almost mandatory.
Yeah, they are absolutely mandatory. If you're flying a stick without it, I don't know what to say.
Doing
I would
wrong.
Not recommend it. Yeah. Next up, you have Palob. Palob, you give the mind link and twin laser turret, and that's it.
Okay.
So what he does at range 1-2. At the start of the combat phase. Notice the theme here, at the start of the combat phase?
Yeah.
He steals a focus or evade token from an enemy ship. So even if all of your ships were denied focus actions, he could still steal it from your opponent.
That's
he also shuts down their action economy. So someone like Poe goes, if I focus, you're just going to steal it, so I can't focus. Or U-boats. That was huge on the U-boats. They're like, oh, wait, he focused, and I was like, I'm going to take that focus. Thanks. You can't fire your ordnance now.
Weegee, I have a question for you on that.
Mm-hmm.
So, let's say you got none of your guys do a focus for their actions or whatever, and start a combat, he steals one. Does everyone else get a focus?
Yes, they do. Because it's whenever your ship is assigned a focus token.
Wow.
Every
That's
other
huge.
Ship is also assigned a focus token, as long as they don't have one. The downside is you also get a stress if you don't if you get a stress. But as long as you your other ships have the ability to get a focus token, you're fine. So I'll talk more about the strategy in a minute. Then all the right. Final ship in the list is Kato Lichos with just the Mind Link.
Yeah, C95.
He's a Z95. Go ahead, make your remarks. Do you want to get anything off your chest, Zef? Just let the rant.
Just a terrible ship, but the pilot ability is decent.
Yeah. Okay. So at start of the combat phase, at range 1-2, he steals a focus or evade token from a friendly ship, which you think is counterproductive at first, but with the mind link, it opens up a lot of possibilities. So say Kato's is like he's about to get shot up by like every single ship your opponent has, and he's got a focus token, and the Sick, who is not getting shot at, has an evade token. He goes, "Hey Sick, I need that evade token right now. Can I have that? Thanks, buddy. I needed that." Or he needs the focus for offense and defense, so he goes, "Hey Palop, you have like 3 tokens. I'll just borrow one." And if they are, let's say for the Sick, in case it only had 1 focus token, he steals a focus token from the Sick. Hey, the Sick doesn't have a focus token anymore. Mind Link procs. It gets the focus token back.
That's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah. It's really fun, because they're all pilot skill 5, so you can really manage your stress very well. So if you need someone to K-turn, you either do all white moves for the other dudes first, and then do the K-turn, and everyone gets stressed, but they did all their actions, and the guy who's stressed has a focus token now, and it's fine. Or you do the K-turn first, everyone gets stressed, and then you do all green maneuvers, and then you still get all your actions to economy and stuff like that. Plus the start of the combat phase stuff where you can steal folks' tokens, assign your token. It's absolutely fun.
It's definitely cute in how the synergy works. Mm-hmm. It is cool that their pilots go 5, so they can beat out the U-boats, they can beat out the TLT swarms. They can even beat out Crack Swarm, because that's at 4.
Yes, it is.
And I think even the Crack A's.
Yes, they could. They could absolutely do that. The trick is stress management and positioning.
And not getting murdered by robots, because that happened,
I threw that game. Matt obviously piloted very well. I did not pilot well, and it happened. It's okay. I still made top 4. I was pretty okay with that.
That's cool.
Yeah, I bounced back. So my first match was against U-boats, and that was definitely one of the hardest, just because of the raw damage output. It came down to Guri soloing it against 2 U-boats, and I managed to eke out that win.
I mean, that was your second match, right?
Yeah, that was the second match, sorry.
Okay. I actually caught one of the trailing end, because you were at the table next to me.
Yes,
I was. The trailing moments of that match. And I looked over while I was finishing off my opponent, which was running like a wonky FO swarm list. He was running Omega Leader with the usual accoutrements.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was a Predator Howl Runner. PS4. It was a PS4 TIE FO with Comm Relay Juke.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they were like middle of the pack TIE Fighters without any crack or anything.
Yeah, Black Squadrons.
And I'm running Tel Trevera with U-boat build, Plasma Torps, Manaru, U-boat build, Proton Torps, and a hired thug Y-wing with dorsal turret, title unhinged. And he just decided to run at me and died for it. Mm. So while I was busy murdering this guy, right, I looked over and I saw 2 U-boats standing, and it was Guri, and I thought, in my head, you are dead. You lose. So how did you win? Because you didn't lose.
I did not lose. I jumped into range 1 of one of the U-boats, like, after the first volley of fire, nothing really happened. Like, well, there wasn't really a volley of fire, because 2 of your ships were out of range, and only 1 U-boat was in range. And he just fired at a Hawk, and he did some damage to it. So then, after he did his movements and stuff, I jumped in with everything. And Palop stole a focus from a dude, Guri got a focus token, and I just laid into one dude before he could even fire any of his ordnance, and I was able to just cripple him.
Okay.
That's the cool. other two got yeah, the other two guys either were out of one of them was out of range still somehow. And no, it landed on a rock. It landed on a rock on accident.
Oh no, that's disastrous.
Yeah, it is. And the other guy did fire his ordnance and he did kill the hawk with that ordnance shot.
So you could say that you outplayed your opponent, or was it were you flying all right and you just made too many mistakes? How I mean
I'd say maybe one mistake, and I was really able to just stay at range one of him and not let him get another ordnance shot off.
Like, if anyone's going to do that, it's going to be like a Star Viper or like a TIE Interceptor or the E-Wing who has the ridiculous maneuverability.
The Sick also has that maneuverability. People forget about it. Like, it can stay at range. It has hard one turns. It can do that barrel roll, block a dude, and just be good.
That's very cool.
Mm-hmm. I think we are kind of skipping over our supposed interview.
Well, we can get to that, because this is all part of it. We can get to that last. We'll save the best for last. Since we're talking about what happened yesterday, we might as well talk about what happened at the final table, which was me and Matt here duking it out. His BroBots, the legendary, I don't know, maybe legendary. But they're really good. Yo, no, not for nothing, but, like, Matt, you are, like, a really good BroBot player. Like, every time you play BroBots, it's just consistent win, win, second place, win, win. Very consistent when you run that. The only times where I've seen you, like, not place in top three is when you run something other than BroBots. So when you ran, like, TLTs, you actually won with TLTs in that store championship. But that was when TLTs were huge. When you ran Dengar when it first came out, I think, didn't we play like a casual game or something and you just died horribly? I don't remember. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, like, BroBots are your thing, man.
Absolutely.
So, let's talk about that final table. What was going on in your head when we got there?
Well, don't get nuked by the torpedoes and pick your targets. And it was a pretty close game, I have to say.
Yeah, it was really tight. And there's just a feeling about being on that top, like on the top table. You kind of feel like you're on top of the world, and like that's it. It's like the final destination kind of feeling. Mm-hmm. And you had a really good opening, too. Just your positioning with those robots were amazing. Like, a really good split where you had all your fire concentrated on one dude. My dudes, I had Tal Trevera up front, but Manaru was out of range for the follow-up shot. The Y-Wing was out of range for the follow-up shot. You just went ham on Tal, but Tal, being known for being a lich, didn't necessarily die when you needed to, didn't it?
Yeah, so Tell, he lived an extra turn, and it allowed you to get your second round of torpedoes off, which was huge.
That was absolutely huge. Got my second plasma torp off. And at that point, it's like, well, the U-boat did its job, right? He can just die.
Yeah, exactly. And, with BroBots, you always have to have arcs, so it's sometimes it's a challenge with the big ships.
Yeah.
And, I'd say I made one mistake that game in positioning C poorly for the follow-up. And I think that cost me the game, I think, at the end.
I mean, isn't it, like, those kind of games where, like, you know, the lists are really competitive, both the pilots are on point, it comes down to whoever makes the least mistakes, and sometimes it's just one mistake that causes you to lose the game. Because I remember back when we were at the Plainview store championship, I had beaten you in Swiss, and then we were back at the top table. We did the cut the top four and went to the top table, and I was the one that made the one mistake, and because we were both running four TLTs, just you were running what's his name, Torkelmux,
and I two tacticians,
Torkelmux with tactician, another I think it's a Spice Runner Hawk with tactician, and then two Y-Wings with TLTs, one with unhinged.
Yep, that's the list.
And I was running four recon Rebel Hawks with the twin laser turrets. The little box of cancerous death that just like floats around in space and just makes everybody miserable.
Yeah, it's a rough list.
But I was the one that made the one mistake. I made a bad turn, and my little box of doom kind of fractured, and you just went to town on it.
Yes, indeed.
So it's really, those games are the best where it was just, it's just, the playing's really good, the players are really good. There's, it just comes down to mistakes, not even dice, because dice could be hot or cold whenever, but it's that one mistake. It's like, oh well, even if my dice were amazing after that, it might not even have saved me.
Yep, I agree.
So speaking of like high levels of play, let's talk about the Hoth Open. You were there. You took 17th place. I believe you told me yesterday that after the first day, all your games were like top table games, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, once you got to day two, everyone in there, they had a winning record, and they were all really good players for sure.
And so, what did you run at the Hoth Open?
I actually ran the same thing I ran yesterday. So I ran IG-88 B and C with Crackshot, Fire Control, Heavy Laser Cannon, Glitter Stim, Auto Thrusters, and the title. So it's really like the way they can do really well is when you pop either Crackshot or Glitter Stim at the right time, because you can absorb a lot of damage. And really not get hurt that bad, and you just dish out a ton. With some glitter stim on them is just like it's amazing. It's a really great upgrade.
Oh yeah, Glitter Stim is amazing. It's just all about timing when it comes to the crack shot and the Glitter Stim. And you kind of use them in concert. Because if you're going to pop your drugs and you're going to push through this damage, you might as well just crack on top of that and be like, no, you're taking this damage. I don't care how many evades you roll.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends. I think the crack shot really comes in great against, like the Imperial Aces or anything that has a high agility that relies on that, where every hull they lose is huge.
Yeah, because high agility ships are really feast and famine when it comes to that because they don't really have the hull to back it up. IGs are like huge because they have the three agility and they have four shields for a hull. They're like the tankiest three agility ship out there. They're a bit of a monsters.
Yeah, so like when TIE Interceptor, it's invincible until it takes one damage. Absolutely invincible. And then when it takes that one damage, it's going to explode in
Your
like.
stealth device is down. It might be a crit, and like, oh, I'm blinded, or oh, my hards are red.
Yeah, and it's just like, it's dead. It's going to die. There's nothing you can do about it. But with an IG, it's like, oh, you took off a shield. Okay, I'm fine. I'm
But
good.
this, Ouija, tell me about the list, because we talked about it last week, the one that won Germany.
The German list,
Because it
actually
was
at the
different from Matt's variant, I think, right?
yes, it had HLC on one of them. The other one had Mangler Cannon,
Oh,
and they both
really?
had Predator. I actually have to pull that up real quick.
Yeah, because I think since we have a
A robot
dedicated
player,
Brobot
yeah.
player here, I think we can talk some shop on
Yep.
this list versus yours,
Okay, yeah,
why it
okay,
won
got it.
Germany.
Okay, so Brobots B and C. Advanced sensors on both of them. One of them had HLC, one of them had Mangler, Auto Thrusters, and Predator.
Which one had HLC?
It doesn't say. I'm gonna guess it was the cannon one where you get the double tap.
B.
Yeah. I'm gonna take a guess it was
Wait,
that one.
they both had Predator?
And advanced sensors.
Interesting.
They both had auto thrusters, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, you have.
You need it.
So instead of fire control, they use Predator and then the advanced sensors.
Yep. So it looks like they boosted before they moved, got that free evade action, and then did their movements or whatever. Like if they're about to do a K turn, they did a
That
focus or something.
really opens up the dial a lot. It takes a lot more pre-planning in my opinion. So, because you don't know what your opponent's going to do, right? So, if you're planning your maneuver based off of boosting first, and then like a turning or whatever it is. I tried doing that when I first started playing robots.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have the exact build. I forget exactly what EPT I had. I think I was maybe running VI and both of them having heavy laser cannon.
Okay.
Just didn't do enough offense for me because, like, let's say you focus before you do your K turn or whatever it is. I had games where I just couldn't land enough damage, and having, you know, the fire control system when you miss, is huge on the second shot with B's ability.
Of course, yeah. So,
you know, I mean, like that... if you have, let's say you don't have fire control, and let's say you're focused or whatever, and you're shooting at someone, if they evade you on your second shot, you have no modifications. It really, really kind of hurts.
Yeah. And you, I think you actually punished me yesterday for it, because you actually rolled terrible, and then I managed to, I think it was with the Y-Wing of all things, right? I think you were shooting the Y-Wing, and I dodged it, and just the look on your face like, ha ha, I got you now!
Yeah, I think I was shooting through a rock or something. I think I did one or two hits, and you rolled one or two evades to match it, and I was like, all right, sounds good.
Yeah, that's like the one opportunity where, like, man, I really just want to blank out right now.
Yeah, you always want to, whenever someone has, like, a gunner or B's ability, it's, taking one damage is, like, the best thing that can happen
to you. Yeah, absolutely.
It's that or being able to dodge twice, which is, I mean, interceptors can do it, and that's about it.
Yeah, unless you're, because, if you're an interceptor, you just don't want to get hit. But most of the time, Scootier has, like, you know, 20 tokens on him or something.
But, of course, that's dangerous against you because you also have crack shot on yours, right? So if you go, all right, I'll take that one damage, you go, no, now it's two.
Yep.
So you force them to go, all right, dodge everything or take two damage. And then, well, if they dodge everything, you go, all right, second shot, boom, where's your mods now?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll joust all day with them, and the only thing that's rough is getting arc dodged by, like, the student tiers and stuff, because you're only pilot skill 6.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, man. So, we talked about the structure of Hoth. What kind of list did you see? Were they a lot of meta lists? Did you see anything funky out at Hoth?
Yeah, so, you know, I could go over, I took notes as to, like, what I played against each round, and then I also, like, when I first walked in the place, because I wasn't playing the first day, we were kind of just at the con looking at, you know, everything that was going on, which Adepticon, it was awesome. It was my first time going. You know, I walked around, I was just kind of scanning the tables, and everyone was, like, really intense into their game, and I saw a ton of triple jump masters, a ton of palp aces. And then, actually, I noticed a lot of ghosts just because, you know, they're a big ship and they're a new ship. So it's kind of like you notice that. And then, yeah, it was. I feel like there was a lot of Imperials out there. That was a big showing.
Yeah, I mean, the ghost, you know, 4 damage is definitely nothing to sneeze at. I mean, that's like power creep on the tier of the TIE Phantom. It's always the spooky ghost ships. That have the ridiculous amount of damage. The TIE Phantom, oh, so spooky. 4 dice. The Ghost, 4 dice. So very spooky.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's always these, like, spooky things. Like, you would think that, like, the Hawk would have a lot of damage, but no, it's actually terrible because they built it originally as a support ship, even though it's like a Hawk, it's a bird of prey, and now it's terrible. It's like a pigeon.
Yeah. it's a New York City pigeon. Yeah,
yeah, right?
Yeah, basically. Occasionally it poops on you, but otherwise...
It's fearless, but, you know.
I mean, it did really good last meta when TLTs were there. Freaking nuclear turds, here you go. 8 damage, turn.
Yeah, I think they would be really quick against U-boats right now.
Yeah, I think the Rebel Recon list could be really good. Well, maybe not, because then I'm running a PS2... You just joust. Yeah, the only thing I would have to do is just run from the joust and then just play sniper, which can work. I've done it before against, like, really spooky needing to joust lists, and that's one of the big things with U-boats, right, is that they need to have all their guns on one target, because if I can't put all my torps at once, it's kind of haphazard. Like, yesterday I was running against Rebel Regen, and that was... I mean, I won... But it's that's just it. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to play that game. It made me want to like kill myself almost.
Mm-hmm. Were you versing the guy who was running Poe, Cornhorn, and Prototype?
Yeah, so he's running Regen Poe. He's running Cornhorn with R2. I think R2 pushed the limit, fire control, and auto thrusters, and like the scrub A wing that's just there to fill points.
Yes.
And I actually meant to go on Corrin first, but it was kind of like I was in a haze at that point. It was kind of hot in the store, and I went on Poe. I ended up killing Poe, but like I spent the second plasma torp shot onto. On the corn, and he just regened it back, and I couldn't push enough damage. And I spent about a good 30 minutes just chasing this freaking E-Wing around the goddamn table. I actually had an opportunity to fire torps, and I was like just so into chasing him down, I fired my primary weapon, which I could have ended the game there. It ended two turns later, but he killed Manaroo. So he got points out of it. So I guess it was a generous... A generous win for me, I guess.
Yeah.
It was totally unintentional. I would have just nuked him to high hell.
I versed him, too.
Mm-hmm.
He was my third game, I believe. So he looked at my list, and he was like, what is that list? There's a Hawk, there's a Z-95, there's a Star Viper, and there's a Sick. I don't know what any of these things do. I've never seen them before. I'm like, I don't blame you.
He's a pretty new player, too, I think. And he does really well, considering he's a new player.
Yeah, I've actually had that reaction before. People are like, what does that do?
That's like
is that a ship in this game?
That's the biggest selling point of your list is just...
It is.
Like, a Star Viper, a Sick, what the... A Hawk? What are these things?
What are
you're running
doing?
A name Z that isn't Blount? What are you doing?
It's pretty fun.
It might even inspire false confidence, almost. Like, especially maybe in, like, veteran players, like, haha, it's a Star Viper. That thing will die because it's terrible and it's overcost, and that's like a piggy bank.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's like, haha, there's a Hawk. It's easy murder. Haha, Z95. At least I would think, haha,
so
Z95.
So we get into the first joust, right? And everything's set up. Everyone's in range to do stuff. He actually has to target lock because Palob's at range 2 now, so he can't do any focus actions whatsoever. And that really hurts Poe, because he has R5, P9, hurts Corn, hurts everybody. So, shots start flying everywhere, he does all his stuff. I managed to get Cornhorn down to 1 health. I couldn't finish him off. And Cornhorn, of course, does a double tap, and I think he kills the Hawk, or lets it be killed next turn. So Cornhorn flies off, he's like, no, I did my double tap, I'm leaving. And I also had done damage to Poe. With the Mangler, of all things. So I got it. I did 2 crits to it. One was, I forgot what it was. It was like a damage engine crit or something. The other one was if you bump an enemy ship, you take a damage. Then he only had 2 health, and he couldn't take focus action, so he couldn't regenerate his shield. So what happened was, during the maneuvering of the next turn, Guri did a hard 1, of course, because she was turned to face Cornhorn, who was coming around.
Yeah.
And I was like, I want to make sure I have arc, so I did a barrel roll, right? And when he revealed Poe's maneuver, it was a 4 straight into Guri.
Oh.
I didn't even think about the crit. I forgot about it completely. And he slammed into Guri and exploded.
Wow.
I felt kind of bad, honestly. I was like, oh, wait.
Star Viper, what a ship. Seems good.
I know. Yeah, it was pretty something.
So let's go back to Hoth. We got a little off topic. So what was your initial run, like your initial record, just from day 1 into day 2?
Yes, so do you want me to go through my matches, or you want to just...
Yeah, go through them, man.
Yeah, go for it.
Give us a lowdown on Hoth.
So day 1, so Friday morning, we're all setting up and everything. I played against a guy that was running Boba and IG-88B. And I think he had like VI. I think he had glitter on both. Mm-hmm. You know, pretty standard stuff for Boba and IGB. And his biggest mistake was he kind of started flying IG-88B away from everything. So I just ganged up on Boba. I even forgot to like crack shot him, and I just like killed him. And then I just focused on B and it was over pretty quickly. Next round, I played two contracted scouts with their Drew, and the Drew had the what's it called? One lone wolf, and he had cluster missiles, glitter stim. You know, so he's pretty kitted out. And then the scouts actually both had bug zappers and protons.
What?
And yeah. So the bug zappers were a real nuisance for me because he did some like wonky positioning, and I didn't have shots, and he would just like bug zap me. And then he was able to eventually line up torpedo shots, and I would like, I think I was like range three, and I would like, I'd blank out on my green dice, and it was just like, I got kind of whittled away pretty quickly. I was able to like one shot in a Drew on the whole reroll thing with the IGB, which was pretty awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a Z95, right? That thing's going to die if you get four damage.
Explodes. But you know, with the bug zappers, they could bump you, and like they've got more hull than I do. So like, if they bump and just bug zap you, it's like, who cares? They don't care about that.
No, they don't.
You know, when you rely on agility, it's like, you know, bumping and zapping Soontir Fell, you don't care, you know, but he cares. So, I end up losing that game. So I'm 1-1 at that point, getting a little nervous because it's only two games in. Right, my goal is to make it to day two.
And you're like 1-1 already, right? That's like not a great start.
Yeah, not a great start. So game three, I played a relatively new player. He was running Farlander with advanced sensors and some other stuff on it. Biggs, and then he had Horton with, I forget exactly what upgrades he had. I think he might have had some munitions or... And it was kind of an easy game for me. I had to shoot Biggs first. I might have killed him in one or two rounds, and then it was just focusing down the other ships. So that wasn't too bad for me. So that was a win. Game four, interesting player. He was running Poe, Biggs, a Scrub X-Wing, and a Scrub A-Wing. And on Biggs, he had, I forget the name of the droid, but I think it makes you like reroll dice and he takes a stress.
I don't remember the droid. I don't see it, so I wouldn't know.
I forget exactly. It was something I never saw. Yeah, it was something I never saw before. And then Poe, I think either it had R2 or 5P9. And it was really weird. I was going into the game, and I guess the game before he was complaining because he played some type of TIE Swarm, and the guy just kept on rolling crits like crazy, and he asked the guy if he baked his dice or something. Basically, thought he was like manipulating the dice and stuff, so he was little salty. He was like really salty coming into the game. I was like, all right. And he kind of flew Poe like too far away from Biggs, and I just like went on Poe, got rid of him, and then it was just downhill for him from there. So, yeah.
I've looked it up. There's two astromechs. There's R7 astromech. If you have a target lock, you spin the target lock to reroll any or all attack dice. And then you have there's another one. R4 D6, where if you hit by three uncancelled results, you take stress until you reduce it to two uncancelled hits.
Yeah, it's that one where you do the stress. Yeah.
Okay.
All right, so there I'm sitting at, you know, 3-1, so I'm feeling pretty good.
Yeah.
And so my fifth game, I come against two TLTYs with Unhinged and Bossk with Mangler, Dengar, Boba, and Forlom. So he had a pretty cool douche canoe going on.
Yeah,
and his mistake was he was kind of like flying away from me, and like he was trying to just like get around me with the Y-wings, and he kind of left Bossk out to dry, and it just kind of came in and broadsided him with both of my ships, and those went down really quick. He ended up able to like I think take out one of my ships.
Oh really?
But you know, I win that game. So right now I'm sitting at 4-1. I'm feeling pretty good. I'm getting to day two, right? So game six, I played against a really a good rebel player. His stuff was really custom painted nice. I took some pictures of it. He had a Stress Hog. He had Jake with Prockets and some other stuff on it. And then he had Poe with the standard Poe build. And
I have one question. So at this
sure.
point, you're already 4-1, right?
Yep.
So at this point, you're already locked for
Day
the
two.
day two. So
Yep.
why didn't you ID?
Cause I don't I'm not like that, you know. I don't
I
know.
mean, you want to have
uh,
fun?
I mean, it might have been your.
Yeah.
I know it never crossed your mind, but like maybe your opponent was maybe 3-2 and maybe needed to win. I mean, you didn't see him
Well,
day
here's the
two,
thing.
did you?
No, I mean, I was playing near him, but I didn't play him again.
Okay.
With the way this tournament is working, is your points for wins and losses and stuff carried over to the next day. So you really wanted to get as many points as possible because it was essentially like almost like 9 rounds of Swiss
Yeah.
to a cut or a cut to top eight. So IDing at that point was, I mean,
I mean, it
it may have.
depends.
It depends, yeah. I mean, it's better because I ended up losing that game. So what happened with that game, I actually was able to get the I was going after the Stress Hog first because I was like, that is the main threat for me. Because once the IGs are stressed or double stressed, they have trouble.
Yeah.
So I was able to get both my ships lined up on it and target lock it. So I'm target locked, I glitter stim, and the first shot I go in and I do 4 damage. And I forget if I even had to use crack shot or not. I don't think I had to. And then the second IG goes, I roll 3 hits in a blank. I re-roll the blank and roll another blank.
Oh no.
So yeah, so I ended up not killing it, right? And because you know, if you get 4 hits, it can't, it just dies, right?
Yeah.
Four hits and 4 hits. Crack shot, there's no way it could defend that. So I whiffed on the reroll with the glitter stim and everything, and what he eventually did was is he shot his primary with the Y-wing at one of them, and then he TLT'd the other one. So both of my IGs were double stressed,
Oh
and
no.
yeah, and then it was just a traffic jam from there, and it was bad times for the IGs.
That stinks.
So that was a Yeah, that was it was rough.
So if you would have ID'd that game, you would have been better off for day two.
Oh, absolutely, yeah,
But maybe
for
not
sure.
if you won like 100 zip.
Yeah, if I got the full win, I would have been in way better shape.
Yeah,
So
so.
really hinged on getting rid of that Y-wing and the dice just didn't cooperate for me.
Yeah. So how'd day two go?
So, day two, everyone's amped up. Everyone day two, they got the new plastic promo card, and they got the Hoth shield tokens, which are pretty cool. So everyone in day two got that. All right. So my first round, I go up against Imperial Aces. It was Soon Ter Fel, Connor Jax, and the Inquisitor. Okay, and like he was trying to outflank me with stuff, and my strategy was to just focus on one guy, right? So he was flying through the asteroid field, and I said, you know what? I need to kill Jax because he takes away my focuses and everything, right? And my evades. So I literally just took him out very quickly. I kind of trapped him. I was going for the bump. I think I may have bumped him. I forget exactly what happened, but he went down pretty quick. And then after that, it was just like, pick your target and just HLC with all your mods and, have a nice day.
Yeah.
So, I was able to win that game pretty well. My second game in day two, so round eight, I played against the a scum player, and this is the guy that had the slaver with Zuckuss, Gunner, and Bosk, which was brutal. He
The
had Torkoal
Geonosian
Mux with the
buzzsaw.
TLT. So he had that. He had Torkoal Mux with the TLT. He had a Y-wing with the TLT, and then he had a Scrubs Z95. And this was probably like the closest game I may have ever played ever. So it came down to me eventually getting behind the buzzsaw. It was everything else was dead. I had an IGB with maybe like 3 or 4 hull left versus the slaver with, I think I might have taken 1 or 2 shields off of him, so he was feeling pretty fresh. And what happened was is I bumped him by like a millimeter, which allowed me to now get behind him and survive the rest of the game with like 2 hull left and end up killing him. And it was really an intense game. It was nuts. But that buzzsaw, it's nasty. It's for real, man. You don't want to get in the arc of that thing, and it's got a huge arc range.
Yeah. The 180 arc is huge.
Yeah, it's pretty dangerous. Yeah.
You know, it's deceptively maneuverable too, because you just do like a 3 turn with that, or you just, even if you do a 1 bank, the angle that changes is pretty intense. So
yeah,
it's hard to dodge it. So I won that game, so I was feeling pretty excited. So I'm like, day 2, I got 2 wins, going to the 3rd round in day 2, and I play against a guy who is running A-wing aces. So he had Tycho with like push the limit, auto thrusters, prockets, and like all sorts of stuff. He had Jake with a similar build. You know, he had the push the limit and all that kind of stuff. And then he had a green squadron with push, auto thrusters, prockets, and homing missiles. And so it was actually really intense day 2. The judges made everyone roll the same dice. So we had shared dice.
Ooh.
Yep.
That's interesting.
So we had shared dice. We also compared range rulers and maneuver templates, because if there was any discrepancies in like third party stuff, you actually shared those too. So everything was like very level.
That makes me think like someone was maybe caught cheating day 1.
Something happened where it was very intense with, you know, comparing everything at the beginning of the game. Yep.
Maybe that guy who was really upset, maybe he said something.
Yeah, I think that's what happened, actually.
Could have been maybe 1 or 2 people. I imagine that would happen. Where, like, yeah, they have a really bad game, or maybe someone really did bake themselves and their dice. Who knows?
Yeah, who knows, man? I mean, people are just kind of crazy. So anyway, this was a really interesting game because the way the asteroids were deployed, it was kind of like a field towards his side. And what he was doing was he was just maneuvering his 3 A-wings like inside the debris field or inside the asteroid field and just making me come to him.
Ooh.
So we literally had like maybe 10 to 15 or 20 minutes of just like posturing. And this guy was, he thought for like, I would say at least a minute before he did his actions, like every time.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it got a little annoying. So eventually I decided to engage him, and, I ended up catching, 2 of his A-wings at like range 3, and he didn't even have like arc on me because he was playing this like dodgy game.
Yeah. He was
bird field.
Yeah.
Able to do a little bit of damage here and there, because you know he's auto thrusters and everything else too. And then what happened was I was able to turn in and focus on Tycho. I end up nuking Tycho, but now I'm like in the asteroid field, so that's a challenge for me. And then so the game played out, and I ended up getting a modified win, and he literally had 1 hit point left on Jake and 1 left on the green squadron. Yeah, so if I was able to just get 1 more hit through, I would have had a full win and maybe have snuck in to top 8. I probably would have been maybe like 11 or 10 or 9 or something, depending on MOB.
Yeah, he just really slow played you though.
Yeah, he did. And what was crazy is at the end of the game, like the time was called and we're in our last round, and he literally spent like 5 minutes before he revealed his tokens. A judge literally came over and was like, yo, you gotta make a move.
That's crazy.
That's nuts.
Yeah, so it was really like draining for me and frustrating because it was like I just needed to kill like 1 more hit.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have had a full win. So anyway, overall day 2 was awesome. I won all 3 games, And, you know, the loss that I had in the last round in day one really affected me making top eight or not, because if I had won that game, I think I may have, like, you know,
should have ID'd, man.
Nah.
You wouldn't have had the loss. You would have had a tie. That's better.
Oh, God. Oh, it's a meme now.
Right?
Basically.
Overall, it was an awesome event, though. They also did this thing called Hangar Bay, which it was 2 days of this. So if you weren't playing in one of the days, or if you didn't make the top cut, you could do like a mini tournament. It was three rounds. So I played in that. I played the first game, and then the second game, I just like kind of threw it, and it was like, you know what? I want to watch the top table, and I was just like, you know, drinking some adult beverages and having a good time. So okay. It was pretty awesome.
That sounds fun.
Kind of reminds me of Kappa Cup. If you didn't make like the top seed, you could do the little battleground sting.
Yep.
So, all in all, Hoth, a good experience. Yes or no?
Yeah, it was an awesome event. I mean, really good players. I mean, it was very structured. Everything was on time. Actually, what was crazy, and I don't know if the weather guy, on the Today Show, apparently he was stranded on a, like, they tried to land his plane three or four times.
Oh my
he
god.
Thought he was gonna die. Yeah. They, like, aborted the landing three times.
Jeez. Did they get him? I assume they got him down eventually, right?
Yeah, eventually, but, I mean, I think they had to refuel somewhere. I'm glad I just didn't get on the plane, because that would suck.
Yeah. All right, so anyway. You're definitely going back next year, right?
Oh, for sure. If they have an X-Wing tournament, for sure, yeah.
I don't see why not. I mean, it seems like Hoth was a pretty big success, and they're doing this whole system open thing with the Coruscant Invitational at, what is it, like the Star Wars Celebration? I think it's going to be like a yearly thing. So, like, in addition to regionals, in addition to nationals, in addition to worlds, you also have this open series. So there's a lot of, you know, new avenues for competitive X-Wing. And I think now's the time to do it, especially since it's X-Wing has overtaken 40K in sales, and they're like, it's the top mini game.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I think that there will wrap it up on that bombshell, and we won't be on next week in terms of doing the actual podcast.
Yep.
It's Greek Easter, and I have a Greek Easter to celebrate. We might have some sort of content available for you guys next Sunday, but for now, we're looking at the next episode of Grim Squadron Radio to be the 8th of May. So I hope you guys join us then. I hope you guys join us for whatever alternative content we have next week. I hope you guys find us on Facebook, that you like us. You subscribe to us. I hope you guys follow us on Twitch. Mm-hmm. I hope you guys enjoyed the podcast. Thanks again for Matt for joining us here today.
Yeah, thank you, Matt.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime, guys.
Awesome. And with that, we're going to close it out here. So to everyone viewing, thanks again. Remember, stay on target, fly casual. Have a great day, folks. Enjoy your weekend.
Yep. Watch out for those rocks.
Watch out for them rocks. They'll kill you.